everyone. Harris O'Malley from DrNerdLove.com, and I have a question for you. How many of you have a friend, or who knows, maybe it's a stranger that you just see all the time? And seriously, what the hell's up with that? They're the sort of person who is just magnetic. You can throw them into any sort of social situation, and they come out with dates and new best friends. And you can't. It hardly seems fair, does it? They can roll into any sort of situation like they've got a natural 18 on their charisma, and then there you are, the unfrozen caveman who suddenly can't word gooder. To make matters worse, you could say the exact same things they do and get blank stares. Meanwhile, there they are, stealing quotes from Shane Black movies, and everyone's treating them like they're Oscar goddamn Wilde. It's one of those things that makes people feel like either you are naturally born with this gift or you've been screwed by the universe. This, honestly, is one of the things that plagued me when I was growing up. Through most of my life, especially in middle school and high school and college, I was, oh yeah, him. That guy who's always off in the corner drawing those weird comics with big eyes and violence and speed lines. And it really didn't help that I was surrounded by all these other people, like my buddy Miles, who looks like what would happen if Zac Efron and 80s Rob Lowe had a love child, who was also in a band, and an actor, and a lawyer, or for that matter, my brother, who is an honest-to-God rocket scientist, and an Olympic-level athlete. And then there's me, unfrozen caveman and crappy artist. You want picture? Pretty picture? I draw you picture. Please. Love grunt. Honestly, I never felt like I could ever measure up to these guys. How am I supposed to have my moment to shine when there are two binary goddamn stars surrounding me at all times? But honestly, the problem wasn't in my resume, it wasn't in my accomplishments, it wasn't in how I dress, and it wasn't in how I look. Okay, maybe a little bit in how I looked. What? It was the 90s. No. My problem was in the way that I acted. Quite frankly, I was a mopey, self-absorbed little asshole. And because there were all these people around me who were just, and because I was surrounded by all these other people who just seemed to naturally get it, to be naturally gifted, I was one of those people who was destined to be awkward for the rest of my life and forever alone. But I was wrong. Don't get me wrong, that doesn't mean that there's a binary state with people who just have it, and people who don't. What other people can do naturally, you can learn how to do. Provided you focus on the right things. See, a lot of people tend to think that getting people interested in you, whether as a friend or a potential good time, has to do with accomplishments and status. This is one of the reasons why pickup artists focus so much on negs, or demonstrations of higher value. Show someone how amazing you are, and they're gonna fall all over themselves trying to impress you. In reality, it doesn't really work like that. This approach is kind of like trying to get someone to date you by showing them your resume. While status certainly can make people want to stick around, it's a little bit like being fabulously wealthy. Having lots of money is a great way to attract women. As long as you don't mind women who are just attracted by money. No, the reason why we like people and why we're drawn to people has nothing to do with status or accomplishments or wealth or anything else. It has everything to do with how we make people feel. That's why one of the most important parts of charisma is simply bringing that positive, warm energy. This is the base for which all other social skills are going to be built upon. This can be an issue because, quite frankly, some of y'all are some morose motherfuckers. Now, I get it. A lot of you are shy, a lot of you are introverted, some of you just really feel awkward, but sullen and closed off doesn't win you any friends. It doesn't get you any dates. There is a reason why Eeyore isn't considered a sex symbol. By anyone. In fact, if you stop and look around at the people in your life, the ones who are the most charismatic, the ones who are the most desired, tend to be the warmest and the friendliest. They're the ones with the big welcoming grins and the open body language and who bring that positive emotion and excitement to every interaction. Which is why it's so frustrating that it seems like so many people have decided their ideal role model are some of the biggest assholes in fiction. The fact of the matter is, people don't want to spend time with someone who makes them feel like shit. House's acerbic wit or Rick Sanchez's Morty, 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 I'm better than all this shit, Morty. I'm smarter than everybody. Nothing means anything. Makes for great one-liners, but horrible relationships. If you want people to like you, you have to send out the message that you are someone who likes other people. This is actually important because we all like people who like us. The people who are showing us that they like us are doing a lot of important work that makes us feel connected to them. They're the ones who, through their behavior, through their attitude, and through their words, are reaching out to us and saying, hey, you seem like you're really awesome, and I would love to get to know you. Whether they use those exact words or not, when someone tells you that they think you're awesome, it feels incredible. And that is the feeling you want to give to the people that you want to connect with. Part of what can help is to just go into the interaction with the belief that you're already friends. Okay, I know this sounds like some woo-woo new age bullshit, but trust me, it works. Attitude is destiny. The way that you believe affects everything that you do, from your body language to your word choice to the energy you bring to the interaction. When you go in assuming that you're already friends, you're much more relaxed, you're much more open, you're warmer, you're more able to focus on the other person than worrying, oh God, what do they think about me? Or thinking about what next clever thing you're going to try to say to impress them. All of that's important because that's going to control the signal that you're sending to other people. If you want other people to like you, you're gonna have to meet them halfway. You can't sit around being sullen McSadface and hoping that strangers are gonna do the heavy lifting for you. I get that you feel awkward around people, but I can tell you from experience, by acting like that, you're telling them that you don't want to talk to them. And most people, quite frankly, don't want to deal with someone who is sending out the signal that he thinks more about the toilet paper stuck to his shoe than he does about them. I'm sorry, there is no manic pixie dream girl out there who's gonna see the potential in you and fight to break down your barriers. They don't exist, and in the real world, nobody has the time for that. One of the issues is that we tend to forget just how much our bodies communicate to the world around us. Negative or closed-off body language tells the world around you that you're not interested in them. For example, never actually looking someone in the eye is one of the universal don't talk to me signs. Crossing your arms in front of you puts barriers between you and the rest of the world. It's a defensive gesture. It says that you are closed off to other people. So does holding things up in front of you or in front of your face or across your body like a shield. Having that stony expression with no emotional affect, or what sometimes gets called resting bitch face, sends the signal to other people that you already don't like them, and why are they gonna wanna invest the energy in trying to change your mind? You may well be a wonderful person with incredible depth to discover and a lot of love to give to the world. But frankly, you can drive people away by giving out those don't talk to me signals, even if that's the exact opposite of what you want. On the other hand, warm, open body language conveys a friendly, welcoming demeanor. On the other hand, wide open body language conveys a warm and welcoming nature. So does warm eye contact. It's part of how we connect with people. We signal our approval that way, and we signal our interest. And seriously, smile. A warm, sincere smile. I don't care how you have to do it. Tell yourself jokes. Imagine something happy that makes you smile. Like, I don't know, imagine a big warm plate of chocolate chip cookies. Damn it, now I'm hungry. I hope you're happy. If you want to know about warm, strong eye contact, what it looks like, how to produce it, I suggest that after you're done here, go and look up videos on smizing. I know, it's a stupid word. Blame America's Next Top Model. Also, I know for a lot of you, eye contact can be really difficult. You're gonna have to learn how to fake it, either by looking at the bridge of the nose, looking at the eyebrow, something. Spend some time. Practice making eye contact with people on TV or on YouTube. At the very least, try to get to the point where you can look somebody in the eye long enough to actually notice the color of their eyes before you look away. You also want to use your face and your expressions and expressiveness to draw people in, to be more charming. Nodding when someone is talking to you is a sign. You're saying, yes, I'm paying attention, I'm engaged, I like what I'm hearing, and I want to hear more. Please keep talking. Similarly, show your emotions on your face while you're talking with them. It's a way of showing how you feel, and helps other people feel trusted, lets them know what's going on with you. It builds a bridge between you and them. This is one of the reasons why that whole Mr. Anderson lack of affect and emotion is really off-putting. It It tells people that you don't care. And if you don't care, people aren't going to feel good around you. If they don't feel good around you, they're not going to like you. If you want people to like you, you have to know how to make them feel good in your presence. When you get right down to it, a lot of modern existence for humans is the pursuit of things that bring us pleasure. This is why we want to spend time with people who make us feel happy or make us feel validated. This is something I've covered many times before, but here it is again. We instinctively prioritize the relationships with people who make us feel good. The better that we feel, the more time we want to spend with these people and just keep getting those little oxytocin hits. This is what's known as the reward theory of attraction, and you can use this to your advantage. Consider, for example, how someone validating us makes us feel. It feels pretty damn good. What's the easiest way to do that? Show them that you think that they're funny and that they're interesting. Imagine how it feels when someone laughs at your jokes. Not just a polite, but an actual honest-to-God laugh. It feels great. When you can laugh with someone, not at them, but with them or at their jokes, you're giving them a gift. You're telling them that you think that they're funny, that you like spending time with them. That makes them feel great. Them feeling great means they're going to want to spend more time with you. The same thing can happen by showing someone that you think that they're fascinating or that you really value their insight or their thoughts. Give them your full attention. Let them feel like there is no place in the world that you would rather be than right here, right now, listening to what they have to say. Let them do most of the talking and you do most of the listening and ask them good questions, meaningful questions, especially questions that can drive home how much you have in common. After all, Paul Abdul and MC Scat Cat lied to us. Opposites don't attract. We like people who are similar to us. The more that you can find opportunities to say, yes, exactly, I know what you mean, you get it, I love that thing too, me too, the more you're bringing each other together. And if you think about it, imagine how you would feel if when you were talking with them, you found out that Idris Elba or Elizabeth Olsen loved the same books you did or had the same hobbies. It's an incredible feeling. It brings you closer together. You want to create that feeling in someone else. And if you can show someone that you think they're cool, that's amazing too. Best way to do that is through compliments. Sincere compliments. But you have to give the right ones. The best compliments are ones that are based around accomplishments, things that somebody actively chose to do or had a hand in. Anyone can compliment, say, a woman on looking gorgeous. And I can tell you that that compliment is boring, they've heard it 1,000 times, and it wasn't very good then either. What you're basically saying is, hey, congratulations on winning the genetic lottery. On the other hand, complimenting someone on things that they have accomplished, that is incredibly validating. What you're saying is, I see what you've done, I think it's impressive. People have put a lot of time and effort into their accomplishments, and finding out that somebody has noticed and appreciates that effort feels incredible and is going to make them feel much better about you. Now, that doesn't mean that you can just compliment your way into someone liking you. That just kind of makes you a suck up. That's why you have to ask yourself the most important question. Can you be fun? Can you make them laugh and feel good? Maybe you can tell some amazing stories. Or maybe you can do something else that helps them feel good. Maybe you can play music. Maybe you can introduce them to this really awesome new game or this new activity. Or even just teach them something cool and awesome. Remember, this isn't about being a dancing monkey and it's not about being a clown. You're not performing and you're especially not performing for their approval. What you're doing is you're trying to connect with them and to make them feel good in a way that is genuine and authentic to who you are. You don't have to be smooth. You definitely don't have to be perfect. You can stick your foot in your mouth. You can stutter. You can make mistakes. You can say the wrong name. It's okay, as long as you're bringing that warm, positive feeling. There's a reason why people talk about someone being adorkable. Perfection is overrated. Genuineness, on the other hand, works far better. Just focus on that warm, positive connection and bringing out the best in both of you. Charisma and charm can feel like magic, and it can feel like something that you have to be born with, but it's a skill. The more that you practice the art of connecting with others and being interested in others and helping them feel good, the more that you will become that charming, magnetic, amazing person that everybody wants to get to know. Hey everyone, thanks for checking out the latest video. You undoubtedly have stories about how you got someone to like you, or crazy things that you tried that may or may not have worked, and honestly, I want to hear all about them. Be sure to tell me your story in the comments below. Meanwhile, if you've been enjoying the video, then please do me a favor, hit that thumbs up and let me know, and if you've really been enjoying the series, then please consider supporting it by becoming a patron at patreon.com/drnerdlove. Even $1 a month is a huge help. I always appreciate it because I can't do this without my patrons. Meanwhile, if you want more dating advice, then check out my books. I wrote them, you want to read them, links to buy them are in the show notes below. Meanwhile, don't forget to follow me on Twitter at Dr. Nerdlove. Join the Facebook page, facebook.com/drnerdlove. Hit the logo to subscribe, check out my other videos, and I will be back with you next week with more tips about love, sex, and dating. Later.